kids across the city, it should be put on hold.
More needs to be done because it's a huge task ahead.
Government's efforts towards education for all.
Whether these schools are providing quality education or not.
And inadequacy of the RTE.
Well, you know, there are one of the things that the Probe report said, the public report on basic education, which came out in 1999, and subsequently others have also said, based on survey work that they have done, is that they find that in the government schools, the chain of accountability is very poor or absent altogether. A teacher can be performing well, but there's no reward for it. A teacher can be performing very badly or being frequently absentee, and there is no penalty for it. So, and that's because, presumably, that is because there is no local level answerability of a teacher. Those who are in a position to be able to discipline the teacher or be able to monitor the teacher's effort are sitting in state capitals or the district capital. They are remote, therefore, from the village where the teacher is working. But those who are able to observe the effort of the teacher, i.e. who are local, they do not have the power and the wherewithal, the authority to bring the teacher to account if she is frequently absentee, for instance. So there is this disconnect. Those who are able to act on it are remote and not able to observe the effort. Those who are able to observe the effort have not been given the power to discipline the teacher. Now, if you look at the Right to Education Act, the 2005 draft of the Right to Education Act, if you compare that with the 2009 version, which was actually passed, two provisions that were there in the original draft, 2005 draft, were dropped by the time that the Act was actually passed. What were these two provisions? They were to do with the extent to which the local village school management and development and management committee, the extent to which it was empowered to deal with teachers, to be responsible for teachers' recruitment, their monitoring and rewarding them in terms of docking pay if necessary, based on frequent absences and so forth. That provision and making teachers a local cadre rather than a district level cadre. These two provisions were taken out from the final version of the Act that was actually passed. So what political pulls and pressures existed that led to the removal of these two acts, which would have very meaningfully decentralized the management of schools to the local level, to the level where the local village panchayat or the school management and development committee is able to observe the effort of the teacher and therefore be able to act appropriately. We do not know what those political pulls and pressures were that led to the removal of those two provisions. But those two provisions would have presumably been helpful in addressing this issue of teacher accountability, engendering greater levels of teacher accountability. Well, it is unfortunate that the Right to Education Act does not, of itself, include such a provision to measure children's learning levels and possibly other outcomes of education. Of course, there are challenges in measuring many of the other outcomes of education. Social science has perhaps not made enough progress so that we can measure things like confidence of children, the extent to which they are able to do teamwork, and the extent to which they are able to interact with each other successfully and make successful members of society. We do not have good measures good ways of measuring these outcomes, which are at the moment rather unobservable and unmeasured. So what we do have available is at least data on that. We do have techniques that are reasonably reliable in being able to measure whether children know to read and write and whether they can do arithmetic. So I think that we should, just because we are not able to measure all the outcomes of schooling that we care about, just because we are able to measure a subset of those outcomes, namely the learning outcome, does not mean that we should not measure at least the learning outcome because we are unable to measure all the outcomes. So that's the point. It is not to say that learning outcomes are the only important outcomes that we care about. We care about a lot of outcomes of education. So then the RTE Act could at least have looked at how this can be done, and we are not alone, India is not alone in the world in having ways of measuring student achievement level adequately and appropriately, and being able, of course it's a very complex area, but nevertheless there are many systems that are trying to reward teachers based on learning outcomes of their children and how much gain in learning outcomes teachers are able to produce from the start of the school year to the end of the school year. And that obviously partly reflects the teacher's effort as well as other factors. So there are precedents, there are examples of good practice in other countries from which we could get some ideas, and we could see which of those ideas are workable and adaptable in the Indian context. So I think it is a good idea. Really, it's important that we focus on outcomes and not only on inputs. That's extremely important. We have tried government production and government funding. We have also tried private production with government funding, which is a kind of public-private partnership, through our aided school system. Now, then there is also the purely private system, where the private sector both produces and funds education. So we have these three different models that we have in our education system in India. And the outcomes from the first two are not very different from each other. The pure government case, where the government produces and funds education, and the second case, where the government only funds education but the private sector produces, which is a kind of public-private partnership. The outcomes from these two types of systems appeared not to be very different from each other. So that might lead one to say that a public-private partnership isn't necessarily a good idea. But I think that would be a very erroneous conclusion to draw. Reason is that it depends. The devil is in the detail of the PPP scheme that one adopts. The public-private partnership scheme that has existed in India, which in fact India inherited from the British at the time of independence, what it has, it's a block grant. So the government gives a certain amount of money, a resource envelope, and it gives that to the private school. And the private school is meant to use that. Now, as from 1971 onwards, there was the enactment in a state like Uttar Pradesh of the Salary Distribution Act of 1971, which meant that aided schools, these so-called private schools that run with public funding, this model of PPP that we had, their discretion on how to use that grant was almost totally removed as a result of that act. Because what this PPP arrangement, their hands were very tied, the management's hands were very tied after that act, because that act stipulated, and similar acts were enacted in all the states of India, for example, the direct payment agreement in Kerala in 1972. So in the early 1970s, these acts meant that what they did is that they centralized the management of these aided schools, so that from that time onwards, the salaries of aided school teachers were paid not by their private managements, but by the government treasury, the state government treasury, so that the scope for demanding accountability from the teacher, the management being able to demand accountability from the teacher, was greatly reduced, because the management was no longer paying the salary of the teacher. The salary of the aided school teacher was coming directly from the government from that point onwards, 1971 onwards. So that was a massive centralization of what was meant to be a public-private partnership model. So it, from that year onwards, i.e. in the past 40 years, that kind of PPP is hardly worth the name PPP. We call it a PPP because notionally, nominally, it is still government funding, but the government funding goes almost entirely to pay teacher salaries, and the funding goes directly to the salaries of those teachers. So it is not that just because we call something a public-private partnership, therefore it must be good. The point is, what kind of public-private partnership, what kind of PPP, and there are many other models of PPP which don't have a block grant system and which don't have that the government gives directly the salary to the teacher. There are other ways known as demand-side funding, whereby the government resource envelope does not go to the school directly. The government resource envelope goes to the parent, and the parent can choose which school they would like their child to go to. So that's the voucher system. But of course, even without the voucher system, another kind of public-private partnership can be when the government gives that resource envelope to the school, but it's not given as a block grant. It is given as a per student grant. I have surveyed many schools in India. Aided schools, the student numbers in aided schools have fallen dramatically. and they are very, very low. I'm talking about the northern state of Uttar Pradesh, particularly, which is where my surveys have been done. I'm not speaking about all states of India, but in Uttar Pradesh, aided school enrollments have fallen dramatically, but the number of teachers remains the same because it's a block grant. Teachers' salaries are short, and the number of teachers are going to remain the same, even if the number of students falls very, very to very low numbers. So this is a big issue with block grants. If it was a per student grant and the student numbers were carefully measured, then it would be more rationalized way of giving funds to private schools, and it would be a better a PPP, which would have a built-in incentive that if you are as a teacher, unless you work hard and are able to attract children to come to your school, you will lose your grant and therefore you will lose your salary. A per student grant would mean that. But that kind of an incentive structure is not built into the current way in which PPPs are run in India. But of course, the Right to Education Act is bringing in another form of public-private partnership by asking all private schools in India, the purely private schools, to take 25% of their students from the weaker sections. And the government proposes to pay the private schools for those students. So that's going to bring in a big new form of public-private partnership in education in India. And we wait to see how that will turn out. But to my mind, the way in which it has been done has not been very sensible. Why not first pilot this scheme in one area or in one district for a period of 2 years, see what the results are, because this is not the only form of public-private partnership that the RTE Act could have envisaged and set up. There are other potential different models of PPP that could have, that arguably have better incentive structures built into them for the private schools to utilize that money more carefully. For example, the voucher scheme system could be one potential PPP arrangement, whereas the resource envelope does not go to the private school, it goes to the students or their families rather. And the families are able to choose, and that would also engender competition between schools and therefore be able to bring presumably a greater degree of cost effectiveness in the use of those resources.